So, hi, my name is Kenneth, and today we're actually going to be talking about my master's thesis in electrical engineering, where I'm going to be examining the ambiguities in the automatic packet recording system. My name is Kenneth Finnegan. My FCC call sign is W6KWF. And today we're going to be talking about APRS. I'm going to give you a quick intro to APRS for those of you.
What is the W in KWF?
The W in KWF indicates, the W6 indicates that I am in the U.S.
No, the middle.
Oh, the middle one? Walter.
Walter, okay,
yes.
Thank you.
So it's my initials. Yes, Kenneth Walter.
Okay.
Oh.
Really? You didn't? Okay, yeah. No, it's my original FCC call sign was KI6RLA, and RLA doesn't really roll off the tongue so well over the air, so I decided to go for vanity. So the FCC charges me about a $1.20 a year to have that call sign. We're going to be going over APRS as a quick little intro for those of you who have never heard of it. We're then going to kind of step through my whole thesis, where I've just kind of been walking through APRS from the bottom up and looking at all of the things about it that are confusing, unclear, and not well-defined. And then at the end, you guys will hopefully ask questions and I'll make up some good convincing answers. Like I said, my name is Kenneth Finnegan. I was licensed in 2008 as an amateur radio operator. I was at UC Davis at that point. And there's my contact info. So what is APRS? Right, so APRS is a ad hoc message passing network for very short messages. Right, the maximum transmission unit in APRS is actually 256 characters. And then the actual message, because of various constraints, we're talking even shorter. So if you want to pass like a text message between two people, we're talking 67 characters, right? So if you think Twitter is short, we're talking half as long, right? So we're talking about very short messages here. The infrastructure for APRS is all based on VHF amateur radio. So in the U.S., we've agreed on one channel, 144.39 megahertz, and it's a 1,200 bits per second packet network, right? 1,200 bits per second. You couldn't buy internet that was 100 times that speed. It's so slow, right? It's based around three different types of devices. What are called trackers, digipeaters, and internet gateways. And so when you send a packet from, you know, so in this example, we've got this little guy running around with a little handheld tracker. He puts out a packet, and then APRS floods it throughout the network for a specified radius, right? And so APRS is entirely a one-to-many multicast network where you put a packet onto the network and it floods outwards radially for whatever distance you specify, and then it just kind of peters off, right? And so what are the uses of APRS? 95% of the application of APRS is actually just for vehicle tracking, right? It's not the only capability of it, but if you ask anyone what APRS is, they'll say, oh, it's for tracking vehicles, right? Literally all you do, all you actually see on the network is people driving from home to work, and then from work back to home, and they put out these beacons of exactly where they are every few minutes, and then no one looks at it. The other popular application is actually for weather stations. You can set up a weather station with an APRS tracker so that it'll read the weather information off of the weather station and put it out on the network every like 10 minutes. And so I know that for a while the club's weather station's actually not online anymore, but for a while we were actually, you know, every 10 minutes we put out, this is the wind speed in this direction and this is how much rain we've had today. Right, so that was kind of a neat thing, which is now broken, but that was the concept. These are a whole bunch of other uses for it that you don't actually see very much, just because that's not what people were interested in using it for. You can pass text messages between people. You can feed arbitrary telemetry information, so you can do like remote site monitoring, battery voltages, temperatures, battery voltages. I mean, even for who does use it, pretty much just battery voltages. You can put out bulletins and announcements, and then you can do remote control command, right? And this is actually one of my favorite things to do with it. What you do is you use the APRS messages to send commands to remote devices that will then react to it. So the Argent data trackers that I use actually have a solid state relay in them that you can remotely turn on and off. And so I have turned on and off lights, radio systems, remotely just by telling the remote tracker, hey, turn on or turn off. Right? And so this is kind of the applications of it, which move through this network in kind of a flooding manner. Is there any questions on that so far? Cool. So like I said, there's three types of trackers in APRS. There's three types of nodes. And my calling the tracker, namology that I'm using here, where I'm calling all moving APRS nodes trackers, is actually relatively controversial. When I presented this to the actual APRS community, they went, no, trackers are a very specific type of mobile APRS. What you need to refer to all moving APRS nodes as is trackers, APRS mobiles, and APRS laptop mobiles, and APRS screen mobiles. And I'm like, well, what's the term for all of those? And they never came up with an answer. So I'm just going to call all of them trackers. And then there's multiple different types of sub-trackers, including what are called deaf trackers. Deaf trackers are ones that actually don't have any receive capability, and so they can only add stuff to the network, not actually receive any remote packets, right? Which for automatic vehicle tracking, automatic vehicle location is perfectly fine because you just blindly throw out packets and they go through the network and you're not concerned with getting anything back. But yeah, so trackers are your mobile APRS nodes that kind of move around and percolate through the system. Digipeaters or digis are these digital repeaters which all listen on the single agreed upon frequency, collect packets, and then retransmit them again on the same frequency. And then internet gateways or iGates are APRS nodes that are connected to the internet and can gateway all of the local RF traffic onto the internet, where they've actually built a full backbone with like dozens of servers to actually transit packets between various local areas, so that you can actually from here on RF send a text message to your buddy in Massachusetts and he'll receive it. Right, so it's kind of a neat system built around these three different types of nodes. So let's actually look at we're looking at the lower layers of the OSI network model here, right? So the OSI 7-layer model, we're looking at layer 1, which is the physical layer where you're actually moving individual bits over a channel, which in our case is a VHF FM channel. We're looking at the data link, how we're framing this information, what we're using it for, which in this case is APRS. And then on top of that, APRS messaging is the guaranteed delivery, because when you're multicasting out APRS messages, they're not guaranteed to reach specific stations. APRS messaging is a system to keep retrying it and guarantee delivery to a specific station. I'm not really talking about that, just to keep the scope here reasonable. HDLC, which I'm going to talk about a little bit, is kind of technically a data link protocol, but I'm just kind of drawing the line here for simplicity's sake, which I'll hopefully go into a little bit. So let's talk about this layer 1 here first. This is all what I'm calling amateur Bell 202. The fact that I'm calling it amateur Bell 202 is new to this thesis. Before I wrote this paper, there was actually no comprehensive documentation on what we used for our modems, right? Everyone called it Bell 202. Bell 202 is a modulation originally used by AT&T. They developed it at Bell Labs. which is normally used over telephone lines. Originally, it was used quite a bit for internet access. Now, it's pretty much only used for caller ID. And so when someone calls you on a landline, which very few people even have anymore, Bell 202 is the after the very first ring, there's a Bell 202 tone modulation sequence, which reads off the number that's coming in to your phone, and that's how your phone can figure out what the caller ID is. And that's why your caller ID doesn't show up until after the first ring. So they originally used it for, you know, on the telephone system. In the early 1980s, 1981, when the FCC finally authorized packet operations on amateur VHF frequencies, there was lots of modem chipsets available for Bell 202, and so that's what we selected for it. Bell 202 is attractive because it's specifically designed to fit in a single voice channel, which means that we can use standard off-the-shelf voice radios. So, like, this is a old commercial radio out of the... I guess this one's actually from Cal Poly, but these are often like out of old police dispatch, you know, police cars, that we just then plug into the microphone and speaker on the front, and we have an APRS tracker, right? So it fits within a single voice channel by switching between two tones, a high tone and a low tone, to indicate ones and zeros. On top of that, we use HDLC, high level data link control, I believe. And the reason why amateurs use that is because it is normally paired with X25, which in the 1980s was still a thing. And so they decided, hey, let's use X25 and then extend it for amateur use, and that's what they then called AX25, amateur X25. And so back in the 80s, they developed this whole specification document based on X25, which they called AX25. I'm kind of doing the same thing on the layer one, in that I'm now kind of documenting amateur Bell 202 to go with amateur X25. HDLC is traditionally presented as part of AX25, but I'm moving it into the modem because they actually don't couple it strongly enough with AX25 to kind of justify us being shackled by that. And then it's transmitted over VHF FM voice. Right, and so as part of my work on this, I literally had to take a couple of the existing modems used since the 1980s, play them into sound cards, and figure out what's going on. These modems are so poorly documented that I couldn't find a collection of documents that definitively told me what was going on. I ended up going, all right, what's the shortest packet I can generate? I played it into a sound card. I printed it out on 8 pages of just audio sine waves. And then I sat there with a ruler and a pen. And for 3 days, I was marking off individual ones and zeros to figure out what was going on. That's how miserable the documentation was when I started on this. Hopefully you can see this. This is a kind of an example. This is a single letter modulated in amateur Bell 202. Of course, Bell 202 from AT&T specified a 1 as 1200 hertz and a 0 as 2200 hertz. And since amateurs are using HDLC, they decided, oh, that's too easy. Let's put non-return to zero inverted on top of that. And so in our modem that we use here, a 1 is indicated by not a change in tones, and a 0 is indicated by a change in tone, right? And so since the least significant bit of A is a 1, the first symbol period here is a low frequency, and the next symbol period after it is also a low frequency. So there's no change, and so that's a 1. Since the second bit above it, you know, of the first four, it's 0001, you'll notice that from the second to third, third to fourth, and fourth to fifth, it does change tone, right? And so that's what that's caused by the fact that HDLC uses NRZI encoding. Um, again, not well explained anywhere. Probably the most problematic part that I had to figure out the hard way was actually the checksum. In the documentation for AX25, they say we are using the CRC16 CCITT checksum. It's a relatively well-known checksum. It's used in a whole bunch of different protocols. Bluetooth uses it. A couple other real early protocols used it. And it's based on, it's a rather typical cyclic redundancy check, checksum, in that you take your whole bit stream for a frame, you divide it by a forming polynomial, and then it comes out with a 16-bit number, which is reproducible. And so when you're transmitting a frame, you calculate the CRC and stick it on the end. Once someone receives a frame, they calculate hopefully the same CRC, and if it's the same, nothing has been damaged, and if it's different, something has changed in the message and has been somehow damaged. Not an error correction code, but just a error detection system. The problem is, in AX25, they specifically say the checksum is sent most significant bit first, bit 15. And it goes all the way to, you know, bit zero last. You then read any articles written by people who have actually built modems, and they say, no, it's really sent least significant bit first, just like everything else. You then go online and search for CRC16 CCITT checksum sample code written by amateurs for APRS. I found 5 different implementations of this checksum, which gave 4 different answers. It was a little confusing. And so again, I go back to my audio capture, and I sat there and I did longhand division, because I got so confused I was doing longhand division on the whole packet to figure out what the actual bit sequence was. And then I realized what was going on. Each octet of the payload is modulated least significant bit first, right? And so if this is your most significant bit and this is your least significant bit, you send this one first, and you work your way up the octet, right? This is the code they have to write for creating these audio tones. Since the checksum is the opposite of that, it sent most significant bit first, you would have to have written another modulating subroutine to support this. The original modems for AX25 were written on Z80 microprocessors with 200 kilobytes of ROM, like UV EEPROM. They made the decision that instead of writing an entire second modem for just the checksum, they calculated the original checksum in reverse bit order, so that when it was sent least significant bit first, that least significant bit actually turned out to be the most significant bit. Not well documented anywhere. And so you had a whole bunch of people saying, no, the actual AX25 spec is wrong, but it actually is. It is right, but everyone calculates by convention. They calculate the checksum in reverse bit order, right? So this shows how, given the original checksum, calculate it in reverse bit order, switch the 2 octets, then modulate it what isn't actually least significant bit first, but is most significant bit first here, and then you actually end up eventually in the right order. Right? I spent a lot more time on this modem than I did on the rest of the actual APRS spec, just because there's no documentation here. Right? So it was hard. I kind of have been cranking through it, and this is where a lot of my time has been sunk. Any questions on the modem?
The way they did it this way because of memory limitations and early microprocessors.
Yeah, they had program space constraints, and so instead of having to implement a bit reversal subroutine or a whole second modulating subroutine, they just calculated it in reverse bit order to begin with, and then used the same modem.
Well, the problem is somebody knows this really well, but there are just like 5 people in the world who ever implemented the.
Yeah, it was the guys who released the original firmware for the Tapper TNC2. And it somehow got lost in history. And so I had to figure it out on my own. Talking to several different people who have built modems, they all said, yeah, I had to figure it out by myself too. but I didn't understand it quite enough to then write documentation on it for everyone else. And so it's been a whole evolution. You can actually kind of, if you look real closely at the code, you can tell which modems are based off of other modems by how they have misinterpreted the reverse engineering of previous generations of it, which has caused a very unpredictable organic network, which is a little bit unpleasant, right? Where, and like we're used to the internet, where we've got 7,500 RFCs, which very clearly outline everything that happens on the internet, and is all very well defined. In APRS, it's all based on, much more of it is based on reverse engineering the previous guy's work, or interpreting what articles he had written. And so it has evolved over the years in a very non-deliberate way. Looking at the actual frame, this top part here is the amateur Bell 202 frame, and then the part below it is the AX25 frame. So I've been talking about just this top frame here. HDLC specifies that you start frames with the octet 7E, right? So it's a 0, 6 ones, and then a 0. You then have the frame payload, you then have the 2 octet checksum for it, and then you have another start, you know, a frame delimiter flag to indicate the end of the frame. How you prevent this octet 7E from showing up somewhere inside the payload is that if you see 5 bits, you add a bit to the end. And then on the receiving side, if you see 5 bits, then a 0, you take that 0 out. It's called bit stuffing. So this is all very relatively well documented and not at all controversial. What is controversial is that a lot of amateurs have started adding strings of zeros at the beginning of their packets. The original hardware modems that we were using back in the 80s were implemented using an audio phased lock loop, where you'd have this modem chip with a phase lock loop that would then lock onto these two audio tones, and as the phase lock loop moved back between the two frequencies, it would output ones and zeros. Over the years, since the phase lock loop is based on resistors and electrolytic capacitors, as they have aged, this phase lock loop has often drifted out of alignment. Again, due to the loss of institutional knowledge, people who are now buying these modems on eBay, you know, second, third, fourth hand, aren't aware that the first thing they need to do is go in and recalibrate these phase lock loops so that they idle in between these two tones correctly, which means that often the sensitivity of these modems is bad. And so by sending long strings of zeros, which since HDLC is using NRZI, a long string of zeros is a continuous transition between the high and low tone, that gives you more energy at the clocking frequency, right? Because each symbol is 1 over 1200 of a second. By continuously transitioning between these two tones, you increase the amount of energy at this symbol frequency, which then helps the phase lock loops lock onto the packet and correctly decode the rest of the packet. A whole bunch of people say, no, that's completely wrong because this isn't in HDLC. HDLC doesn't talk about this at all because HDLC isn't concerned with the actual layer one modulation, which is why I kind of have moved HDLC into layer one and said we're changing it. So there's a lot of people saying, no, this is wrong, we shouldn't be doing this. And the counterpoint to that is it apparently significantly improves throughput depending on which specific modem you're using. Scott Miller said that, yeah, there's digipeaters that will not correctly decode packets until you prepend this string of zeros at the beginning of it, and then they'll start decoding packets. And so this is kind of just a reality that we probably want to make this modification to the spec, just as a pragmatically say, hey, we need to do this. Many, many emails arguing about this going back easily a decade. There's 44,000 emails on the APRS, you know, main mailing list. I've read about 4 or 5 years of the archives, and topic comes up regularly. Um, So inside this frame payload is, in this specific example of APRS, we transport AX25. AX25 has a couple, this is all the headers, and then this information field is the actual layer 3 payload, which in our case is APRS. If you, in all of the documentation for AX25, they show these HDLC headers as part of the AX25 frame. When you transport AX25 frames over any data link except for Bell 202, it doesn't include these HDLC frames. And so the serial protocol interfacing desktop computers to these modems have until now used a subset of the AX25 frame that has been documented nowhere. And so the fact that I have just said these flags are in layer 1, AX25 frame doesn't have them, is surprisingly novel. APRS specifically also abuses a few of the fields in AX25. AX25 is much like Ethernet, where you have a source MAC address, a destination MAC address, you know, your protocol type, and then your payload. AX25 has a source address, which is a FCC call sign traditionally, a destination address, which is also a FCC call sign, your routing path, which is which digipeaters to go through, your protocol identification and some control stuff, and then your payload. APRS, since it's a one-to-many protocol, they kind of implicitly decided, what's the use in a destination address if we aren't actually ever going to send stuff specifically to another station? And so they've overloaded the destination address to include more information about the packet. There's several different proposals and implementations for what to use that field for. The most popular, or one of the more popular ones, is use it to describe the modem you're using and the terminal node controller you're using. And so the APRS working group allocates these prefixes so that if I were to build a new modem, I would go to them and say, hey, can I have a TNC identifier? And they give me this 6-character string that when anyone else sees traffic on the APRS network, they can look up that string and go, oh, this terminal node controller was built by Kenneth Finnegan, I should tell him that it is somehow grossly misbehaving, right, if it were. So instead of it being a destination address, it's actually a TNC description field. The routing paths in APRS, I'll talk about that a little bit later. The control field is always the hex 03 because APRS uses strictly unnumbered information packets on AX25, right? So it's just what APRS uses. It's fixed. And then it uses the protocol identifier F0, which indicates no protocol at all, which is a little strange because we're using APRS on top of this, so there is a protocol. I found no definitive explanation for this, even talking to a lot of the guys that were working on this at the time. None of them have been able to give me a good explanation. Picking up a few hints, I'm theorizing that the PID indicating no protocol is because the Tucson Amateur Radio Packet Corporation that wrote the AX25 spec stopped bothering responding to new protocol identifier requests. And so when they developed APRS as a new protocol layered on top of AX25, presumably someone at some point requested a new protocol identifier, Tapper never responded, and so they just went with the there is none. That's my theory. I haven't had that actually confirmed, but it kind of indicates how we're building on top of older technologies here that aren't well maintained. Any questions on those AX25 fields? Cool. So let's talk about kind of the one big innovation of APRS that made it much more useful and made it outlive all the other AX25 applications. Because in the early, in the mid-80s and early 90s, AX25 was absolutely huge. There was the AX25 network actually spanned the entire United States and was composed of a very large number of bulletin boards where you could actually send and receive email over AX25, and you could address it to someone on the other side of the country, and it would eventually get there in the order of like a few days. Because they had a whole routing system. They had several long-range HF hops. At one point, part of the network actually bounced through a satellite. It was a very sophisticated system that was all based on this explicit addressing of to get from here to there, route through this system, then that system, then that system, then that system, and then you'll get there. This is at the same time that the UUCP system hadn't been beaten out by email yet, and so this wasn't a profoundly terrible system at the time, but now it's kind of inconvenient because users don't tend to like to have to know what the internal infrastructure is to be able to use it, right? When you send an email to someone at Gmail, you really don't care what hosts are in between you and Gmail. This system is still, AX25 existed at a time when that just wasn't the case yet, and so they thought it was perfectly fine to require you to have to explicitly list all of these hosts. APRS came up with the idea of, instead of specifically listing which digipeaters to use, let's have all digipeaters respond to this single alias of wide. Right, so wide just indicated, flood my packet outwards, which for APRS is appropriate since it's a flooding protocol. Of course, in the beginning, I'm presenting this like they knew what they were doing. Originally, there was somewhere in the order of about 8 different aliases that throughout the years, as people didn't bother implementing them in their reverse engineered implementations of previous systems, it has kind of got to the point where wide is the only alias still used because it's the only one you need for automatic vehicle location. So the wide alias has 2 numbers after it, the first of which indicates the number of hops that you originally requested, and the second one being the number of hops left to be consumed. And so if our little tracker here were to put out a packet with a routing path of wide 2-2, that indicates that he's requesting 2 hops through repeater, through digital repeaters. He would transmit the packet with wide 2-2. This digipeater high A would hear it, receive it, process it, and go, oh, this guy's asking for 2 hops. I can provide the first hop. High A would then retransmit it with the routing path of wide 2-1. 2 hops originally requested, 1 hop left. High B, the second digipeater, you know, the next town over, would hear this repeated packet and go, oh, look, wide 2-1, whoever it was originally requested 2 hops, there's 1 hop left, I can provide that second hop. And he would send it out with the routing path wide 2-0, indicating that they had all been consumed. Works fairly well, because now our tracker can program this, you know, this guy in this truck can program his tracker with the routing path wide 2-2 and drive from California to New York and anywhere that there's APRS coverage. Since all the digipeaters respond to this alias, they all repeat his packets. In traditional AX25, every time that he moved out of range of a digipeater, he would have had to stop, listened for about 5 to 30 minutes, figured out what the next digipeater is in the network, and hard code that host into his routing path. Aliases made the concept of moving around dynamically in this network viable. They also segregated digipeters into 2 different levels, high-level and low-level digipeters. Low-level digipeters would generally be your tops of houses, bottoms of valleys, you know, and canyons, and had relatively small coverage areas superseded by the nearest high-level digipeter, right? And so if the low-level digipeter covered this area, the high-level one would cover much more than that. Right, all of the low-level coverage plus much more. The value in the low-level digipeaters is that they are much better equipped to hear very close nearby stations and then relay them up to these high-level digipeaters, right? And so if you had a little 5-watt tracker, right, it's like this tracker here only puts out 5 watts, it's more likely that you can hit the house down the street than you can successfully hit the digipeater up on the top of the nearest peak. And so originally they supported a separate alias called relay. And so if you were using one of these low power trackers, you would say, relay me through the lowest low level digipeater, which will then get me up into the high level digipeater network, and it'll be heard from there. Due to a specific bug in the Cantronics KPC 3 Plus TNC version 8.8 and 9.0, there was a deduplication bug with how it handled this relay alias, which proved to be fatal. Cantronics never really admitted that it was a flat-out bug. They said it was a, what did the salesperson call it, a anomaly, and they were charged $40 to sell you the new revised 9.1 firmware programmed onto a little chip that you have to physically pull out the old one and plug in the new one in all of their terminal node controllers to fix this bug. Needless to say, for $40 plus a trip out to wherever your digipeaters are and a physical disassemble the whole box and replace it IC, it hasn't happened. This bug has been around for a decade, and most Cantronics TNCs still suffer from it. And so the APRS response was, let's get rid of the relay alias. The problem was getting rid of the relay alias left us with no alias to indicate low-level digipeaters. And so they then proposed, hey, let's just use the alias wide1-1 as a literal replacement for relay. The problem with using wide1-1 as a replacement for relay is it left no alias for requesting a single high-level hop. Because if you said wide1-1, you're requesting a relay. So how do you request one wide? And the proposal was, well, let's just use wide2-1. Which means that from the original tracker, you're literally saying, of my two original hops requested, there is one left. Which isn't true because you only ever started with one, so there's only one original request, but you're claiming there was two. Breaks the original interpretation of these two numbers, but in reality it works. What this does mean is that the meaning of the first number has actually now changed. When I was discussing this with several of the members of the community, they didn't all agree on this new interpretation, even though it's been around for a decade. Right? I'm like, so doesn't it really just mean if this first number is a 1, we're requesting relay hops, and if it's not a 1, we're requesting high-level hops? And there still isn't a consensus on that. But that's effectively what it means in most areas of the country where they've updated this new policy. This one exception has managed to confuse users enough, since it hasn't been well documented and it's not a consensus. Oftentimes, you will see aliases like wide1-2, where of the one originally requested hop, there's two remaining, and wide2-3, where of the two originally requested hops, there's three remaining. Three left over of the original two. Right, it's a little unfortunate. This problem, I did some measurements where I captured all of the worldwide APRS traffic for 24 hours. These sorts of nonsense aliases are actually about 700 parts per million of the total national traffic. So clearly users are a little confused. So wide is about the only alias. A lot of local networks will actually come up with their own ideas of, hey, let's have another alias just for San Luis Obispo. And so APRS supports adding additional local aliases, but the only generic, ubiquitous one that we really want to talk about is just this wide one. Is there any questions on this specific routing stuff?
Cool.
moving along. So, APRS defined this wide alias as a concept of, this is how you address all of the digipeaters in the entire network, so that when you send a packet out with a specific path, it travels through the network in this way. Which is controversial, and that there's kind of a moral hazard that as a single user in it, you're kind of tempted to like request 7 hops, because then you'll cover most of California, right? How cool would that be to be able to be heard everywhere in California just driving around San Luis Obispo? The problem is if everyone in California were to beacon asking for 7 hops, the entire network would roll over and die because it's only 1,200 bits per second, right? So there's a moral hazard there that's very controversial and is a source of plenty of arguments. And honestly, the only solution to that is we need to really ask people, hey, please don't use more than 2 hops, right? In the Bay Area, you oftentimes only need to use 1 hop, or if you're just trying to get to internet gateways, you can actually use no hops. And so when I'm just driving around in the Bay Area, since there's so many internet-connected APRS nodes, you don't need to use any digipeaters at all. You can just operate simplex and it works. The second half of the question of when do I beacon and how far is, when should I add information into the network? For infrastructure nodes like a digipeater, it's relatively simple that, you know, yeah, every 10 minutes just say, hello, I'm here, this is where I am, and if you want to relay through me specifically, you know, here's my address. For mobile stations, like a car driving around, the question of how often and when should you beacon your location becomes a lot less obvious. Right? If it's a 10-minute commute from home to work, if you beacon once every 10 minutes, that's a single beacon somewhere along your commute, which isn't a very useful or interesting piece of information. And so people will then say, well, let's beacon every 30 seconds. Right? And so suddenly everyone's beaconing every 30 seconds, and that again, overloads the network. And so they've started to come up, so over the years, various terminal node controllers have supported these different algorithms for deciding when to beacon. The basic one that I talked about was called fixed intervals, where you just say, from whenever I turn you on, every X number of seconds, send out a new beacon, right? For digipeaters, this works well. Pretty much every terminal node controller supports this. The second mode of beaconing is called time slotting. Since all of these trackers often have GPS receivers in them, they have a very high quality sense of what time it is. And so if you've got 20 trackers in vehicles for, like, say, an event, and you want to know where all of your support and gear vehicles are, if you assign each one of them a time slot so that, you know, all right, 1 second after the hour, you beacon, 2 seconds after the hour, you beacon, 3 seconds after the hour, you beacon, and in this rolling pattern, you can get a very, very high quality fix on all of your vehicles because you've designed what bandwidth is allocated to which user. Tends to not be very useful in the nationwide network because we're not going to coordinate and allocate everyone in the US a time slot, but for small insular networks like Cal Poly builds for the Wildflower Triathlon, where we have 20 trackers on a single network on a different frequency that is all under our control, it makes a lot of sense because you can suddenly start putting packets one right after the other and you don't have to worry about the collisions involved in what in the national network is an intrinsically random access channel, right? And so time slots is this very designed, you know, hand of God sort of protocol where one person designs and allocates all of the bandwidth. Cool. The third one is nice intervals, which is actually only supported by, I've only seen it supported by Argent data trackers, and that's the concept that beacon often, but if you hear any high-level digipeaters successfully repeat your packet, skip the next X number of beacons, right? And so when I'm out driving around in the, you know, in the hills and valleys of San Luis Obispo, I can tell it, beacon every 30 seconds, but as soon as I, you know, beat the odds and actually manage to get into one of the few digipeaters in San Luis Obispo, skip the next few beacons because clearly other people have heard me now. right? So at that point, you can have very rapid beaconing where there's little coverage, but then very intermittent beaconing where there is coverage and there is other traffic. It's a controversial feature because, it's a controversial feature because in addition, because hearing your echo depends on the channel not being so overloaded that the digipeaters can't successfully decode and that you can't successfully receive it. There's no way in the modems to differentiate between not hearing an echo because the digipeater didn't hear you and not hearing an echo because the entire channel is grossly overloaded and no one can hear anyone. And so it's, again, kind of this feedback that, well, it's, you know, it's this moral hazard that if I beacon way too often that I then break the network, I'll then beacon even more often to try and, you know, beat out everyone else in the network. So it's a controversial feature which there isn't agreement on. Fixed interval with dithering is something that I haven't seen widely supported in almost any trackers, but is, I found one guy's email talking about the theoretical viability of it, which is based on the concept that APRS is a random access channel. Since we are all rolling the dice every time that we throw a packet out into the channel that, well, hopefully someone else will hear it, a lot of the traffic channel modeling is based on statistical models developed at the 1970s at the University of Hawaii for their Aloha network. Right, so these are all called Aloha networks because they're based on this original work. Dithering is a concept originally developed in computer science for computer graphics, where you deliberately add noise to a signal to kind of make it work better. The original example of this was actually the bombing computers used in World War II. There were a whole bunch of gears and cogs and stuff that you would feed in the airspeed and how fast the airplane was going and how high you were, and then it would tell you exactly when to drop the bomb so that they would fall on your target. These bomb computers worked better up in the airplanes in combat than they did on the test benches back in the labs. And they finally realized it's because since they're vibrating the computer, the gears wouldn't stick as much. And so that's where the concept of dithering came in, that you introduce randomness to make stuff not so sticky and tend to spread it out. If you have a whole network of fixed interval trackers, there's almost no randomness introduced by them. And so if you happen to turn two of them on at the same moment, and they both beacon at the same time, you'll never successfully decode either of them. In the basic model of, you know, if they collide, you lose. And so by adding some source of entropy into each one of the trackers, even if they do start by colliding with each other, they'll eventually spread out, and that'll kind of take care of itself. Implemented in almost nothing, the actual value of it is theoretical and would take a lot of analysis for what is the actual entropy characteristics of the APRS network, which in San Luis Obispo, I could do an analysis of San Luis Obispo, but since this network varies as you move throughout the country as far as geography, the intrinsic characteristics of APRS actually changes quite a bit, right? In California, we have lots of high mountains that mean our individual cells are 100 miles, 200 miles wide. On the East Coast, where it's hillier and smaller and flatter, if a single digipeater can hear more than 20 miles away, it's a fantastic digipeater, right? In California, a digipeater that's 8,000 feet up in the air that can only hear 20 miles means something is grossly wrong, right? And so there's this kind of difference in impedance of the network as you move around. And so analyzing the characteristics of the channel is tremendously hard. And so I just skipped it. The fifth one is called smart beaconing. And this is where vehicles actually, it is the algorithm that really excels for vehicles. When you're driving around in a vehicle, it tends to be relatively uninteresting until you turn a corner or change speed, right? So if I'm driving along on a freeway, I tell my APRS tracker, beacon every so often. And then smart beaconing introduces this concept of adaptively change how often you beacon depending on how interesting the information is. If I turn a corner, that's relatively interesting because I've suddenly changed direction. So let's cause a beacon. If we change speed, if we speed up, that's relatively interesting. Let's send out a new beacon. And so the guys at HamHUD, which was the company that was making a tracker kit that originally developed this, posted on their website a snippet of pseudo C code implementing this algorithm for other amateurs to use free of charge for non-commercial applications. The issue is their pseudo C code has bugs in it. There's an off by one error. They set two variables equal to each other in the corner condition, and then they check if one of the variables is greater than the other one to beacon. So when you turn a corner, it sets the beacon interval equal to the length of time since we've beaconed. Then immediately after that, it checks, has it been more than our beacon interval since we've beaconed? And if they're equal, it hasn't, and it doesn't beacon. The code that they post online would never beacon when you turn a corner. I pointed this out to them, and they said, no, it works fine. We've, you know, it's been implemented by dozens of people. They also used multiple different variable names for the same variable in 12 lines of code. They used different conventions for the low, high, and turn interval rates. Like, one of them, it's like, it's low interval, high speed, beacon interval, and turn rate are the three variable names they use for it, which is a little confusing. And so I just figured out what they really meant to implement with that C code and have retyped it here, right? So I'm hoping that anyone who goes to implement smart beaconing on a new piece of hardware can look at this figure here and go, ah, that's how it should actually operate, right? And so that's kind of the big contribution here. So there's a question of how often you should beacon, and there's also a question of what paths to use. The aliases of wide are what is intrinsic to APRS and what makes APRS useful, but the documentation doesn't give any guidance on which path to use, which introduces that moral hazard that people use wide 7 and flood the entire network. Reading lots and lots of emails and kind of growing a comprehensive understanding of it, I've come up with these three specific recommendations for what you should generally use as defaults. Whenever people post these sorts of recommendation lists, other people on the APRS mailing list will go, no, that's nonsense because there's some exception. In Los Angeles, you don't want to use this path, you got to use this path instead. If you're in North Carolina, they have some local alias that, you know, and so then suddenly this 3-point bullet list becomes 4 pages, and normal users that don't want to spend 11 months studying APRS like I did don't read all of the documentation and inevitably make some bad choice about what path they use. On the mailing list, they called this the weekly bad packet of the week. And they would show, you know, oh, look at this idiot. He's using, you know, like 8 hops and what nonsense. One of the best ones I saw, he was requesting 14 hops through terrestrial digipeters. There's actually an APRS digipeter on the International Space Station, so they requested one of those as well. And then there's a digipeter on the PCSat, which is an amateur radio satellite that they launched. And so they requested a hop through that too. So they were asking to go flood out 14 hops radially. Then any of those 14th digipeters that happen to be able to reach the International Space Station, the International Space Station should relay it. And then the PCSat, if it happens to be in the same hemisphere, should also relay this packet just to make sure that he's heard. Giving very clear guidelines of you should use these paths and you should really know what you're doing if you're using more path hops than this is something that really needs to be done, right? It's a user education problem. The airborne path concept of not using any digipeters is one that actually wasn't documented at all before I started my thesis, and it was actually during my thesis that they again called out some university launched a weather balloon with an APRS tracker on it, and they requested two hops at 7 second intervals. So every 7 seconds, this weather balloon at 30 or 40,000 feet requested two hops, and it shut down the entire New England APRS network all day. All day, the only thing you could see on the New England APRS network was where this weather balloon was. Made it real easy to recover it at the end of the day. Also didn't make them a lot of friends in the APRS community. When you're 30,000 feet up, you have better coverage than any of the digipeters that you're gonna possibly use. And so it's not advisable to use digipeters when you're airborne. The problem we have in San Luis Obispo specifically is a lot of private airplanes commuting between LA and the Bay Area will fly over requesting a couple hops from like their Cessnas. And I've contacted a few of the users and said, hey, you may want to reconsider this configuration because you're flooding the San Luis Obispo network with this all of this airplane traffic from, you know, where you're flying over I-5. And they go, oh, I had never even thought about that. Thank you. And then they fix it. Right? So it's a user education problem. Given a clear, concise guideline, these users are perfectly willing to fix their mistakes, just no one's told them about it. Right? And so that's kind of a problem. Finally, just like how Smart Beaconing is an adaptive algorithm for the beacon intervals, proportional pathing is a adaptive algorithm proposed for beaconing paths where, again, you don't always send information on a fixed interval at a fixed path, but actually modulate how far out the information goes based on how important it is. The only example proportional pathing algorithm I've actually seen so far is just feed in a fixed list of paths and it'll rotate through it, right? And so for a relatively unimportant station, you could say four out of every, you know, every hour, send four of your beacons with no path, one of them with one hop and one of them with two hops, right? So every hour you'll get pretty good coverage, but most of the time you'll be relatively self-contained. There hasn't been any sort of like actual adaptive algorithms developed for, you know, when you turn a corner, beacon with two hops, when you change speed, only beacon with one hop, and when you're just going in a straight line, beacon with nothing. There hasn't been any development on that front, and that's something that someone should probably look at, right? So again, here's a bullet point for if someone wants to work on something, that would be relatively interesting. Any questions on the routing aliases and then the beaconing intervals? Cool. I've put you all to sleep or put you in stunned silence. The last part of my thesis, I kind of punted a little bit. This is looking at the actual 1200 bits per second channel capacity. 1200 bits per second is how much data you can move from one station to another single station through this network. The actual effective throughput is much less than that, right? Just as how in Ethernet, you're not always gonna see 100 megabits from every system to every other system because there is an inherent overhead in the queuing and the channel access and the framing. And so I pointed out that there hasn't been real definitive questions asked and answered in the APRS community as far as what is the actual channel capacity given that we're starting with 1200 bits. And this is a problem that's gonna take a lot of characterization of the actual network and the actual behaviors to actually start plugging stuff into the statistical models that then give you this sort of result. What this graph shows right here is this is the most simple model for this sort of statistical channel access where everyone is random, everyone's beaconing the same packet length, and any collisions wipe out both packets. The bottom axis here is how much traffic we're feeding into the network based on normalized to a channel capacity. So one here indicates 1200 bit per second of packets being fed into the network, and then a one here would be 1200 bits per second coming out of the network. The peak here indicates that the optimal throughput happens when you're feeding about 600 bits per second of user information into the network, at which point about 18% of 1200 bits per second comes out of the network, which means that 2/3 of the traffic you feed into the network is lost. This is a very simple model that ignores most of the realities of APRS, but since I had spent 11 months on this already, I kind of didn't feel like spending another 6 months just working on this one question, so I'm punting it to whoever is interested in working on it. The biggest problem with this model is that collisions don't necessarily kill both packets. FM receivers tend to capture a single signal, which the best example of this is actually if you're driving up 101, pick a radio channel, a radio station, and stay on it from here to the Bay Area. You'll hear it switch back and forth between different broadcast stations when you're moving in between the ranges of coverages of the two of them. Same thing happens in APRS since we're using voice FM radios. And if it happens to capture on one of the two packets and stay locked to it the entire packet length, it'll successfully decode one of them, even though a second packet will overlap it. The actual effectiveness of this theory, which everyone swears by in APRS, questionable, and I haven't seen any definitive proof of it. It's a little bit hard to test because you need to have multiple different digipeaters synchronously retransmit packets and see what happens given these collisions, and you have to have specific signal-to-signal ratios. I tried to do some testing for it, but couldn't get any actual quantitative results, right? And so this is something that needs to be worked on, but I couldn't figure it out given the breadth of all of the other questions that I was finding, and then I've given a lot of those answers to you right now. So that's kind of what most of my thesis has been, is just digging through all of the documentation already written, identifying where there's been things that have been relatively confusing, and then trying to find consensus where there is some, and when there isn't really any consensus, or I couldn't figure out a good way to answer the question, merely identified as, hey, this is a problem, we should look at it. My actual 80-page document isn't, I mean, ideally it would have been a implementer's guide to APRS. You know, when you're building a APRS node, here are all of the things you need to concern yourself with, but it didn't actually definitively become comprehensive like that. And so I considered this document about the first half of the shopping list for what we need for this actual document. So the actual project of writing something akin to like the RFC series of documents to, like, this is how the internet is very well defined. We need to start this project where we well define APRS to the same level of detail so that we can start getting consistent behavior between all the different nodes, and it's a very, very large project, right? So I've shown some of the problems that we're going to need to tackle when we do this, but moving forward, we're going to find more problems as we start turning over more rocks, because that's been pretty much my whole thesis so far. All right, so now I'm going to take any questions. Once we're done with questions, the committee is going to start making fun of me in private, so everyone else can then leave and please have more donuts. And then hopefully at the end of this, my work will be decent enough that I'll maybe get a master's degree in this. All right, thank you. Any questions at all?
Okay.
Yeah.
So you talked about the various wides, and something I was thinking is, has anyone ever thought about doing a routing method where it says, I want to be repeated to my signal, like, or my location gets out from like 20 miles or 25 miles from here? Something like that.
Yes. The original alias sets included paths that say, take me north, take me south. Turned out to not be very useful. As far as specific radiuses, that ironically requires more intelligence than a lot of the digipeters have, right? So in the original design spec, right? And we were talking about devices that had 8 bits of horsepower and 128 bytes of RAM. That's a good idea. It's not part of APRS.
What is the digipeter coverage in San Luis Obispo? How many are there, and is it well covered or is it not well covered?
When I started here at Cal Poly, the coverage was very bad. Now it's actually fairly good. What we have is up on... Here is San Luis Obispo. Oh, look at that. KK6 something NR. So here's someone actually driving down Highway 1. When I started here, the only digipeter that was set up was KD6DSI-5. This is on the top of Cuesta Ridge. Great coverage. It's also pretty grossly overloaded. This digipeter is high enough that it can hear all of the digipeters on the rim of the South Bay, and so your chances of getting into it from a lowly tracker down in the San Luis Obispo Basin is not particularly good. Last year, Tom Tangen set up this digipeter over here, which has been a phenomenal improvement, and then Tom Tangen set up an internet gateway at his house, and we set up an internet gateway on campus. These two internet gateways, which are kind of equivalent to low-level digipeters, have improved coverage inside the city.
So there's a digipeter on campus here, then?
It's not. It's a receive-only digipeter. Ideally, it would be it would actually be a digipeter, but since
It routes to the internet.
So it only routes to the internet, and that's actually because we had a spare radio that the power amplifier was blown out on it. It had been damaged. And so we allocated it to APRS use. And that's very representative of the fact that APRS is mostly built on this secondhand last choice hardware, which kind of makes the challenge of making this work well even higher. And so we have very good internet coverage within San Luis Obispo, and Tom Tangen's digipeter up here really was the keystone to finally getting good coverage on the RF side driving around in this.
So it has a high location then?
He's got a medium level location.
Okay.
Right? Because what's kind of counterintuitive, you don't always want as big a cell as possible. Right? When you're out in the middle of nowhere, yeah, cell phone companies want really big cells. Right? You start looking at like places like San Francisco where cell phone companies are making their cells one city block, half a city block big. It's the same thing that you want cells that kind of meet the local network needs. This cell here is kind of too big because it's overwhelmed by traffic coming from the South Bay and can't effectively service us within San Luis Obispo. Does that answer your question?
Just give me an idea.
Sure.
Yeah. But yeah.
Are there big gaps if you go north?
King City is completely dead. When you drive north of here, you fall off the face of the earth once you hit Monterey County, and you don't see yourself for 100 miles. There's no coverage at all in King City. And so the club has actually at times kind of just shopped around. You know, we're looking to see if anyone knows anyone in King City just to say, hey, can you give us an internet connection and we'll put something up on a mast and plug it into your house just because we want to have better APRS coverage on the way up through King City. So yeah, there's huge gaps. And when you go out in like the Midwest, there's like half of states that have no coverage, right? And that's just it's based entirely upon volunteers building local infrastructure. And so if there's no one there to build the infrastructure, it doesn't happen.
Can you get like coverage maps where you can see, say, we're 227 or even, you know, very local?
Yeah, Bob Berninga loves to push this concept of an Aloha circle, where you actually draw perfect circles around stations. Particularly in places like San Luis Obispo, it's hard to draw coverage maps as circles because the geography is so dynamic. This website that we're looking at here is the APRS.fi website, which is fantastic. And for that, you can actually click on a single digipeter, and then down here, it'll say stations heard directly. this digipeater has apparently heard 19 other stations directly in the last month, I believe, is their time period. And then you can ask it to show you a heat map. And so, yeah, it shows you a heat map here of where the coverage is. This is coverage based on the traffic put into it. And so even though it indicates no coverage up here, it very well may cover this area great, but there's no traffic there to repeat. And so that kind of confuses these heat maps as far as figuring out exactly where their coverage is. When we're using like APRS for a special event, like the Wildflower Century Ride up here, what we did is the week before, we drove out with one car and very meticulously just drove along it and beaconed every X number of miles. And then we checked to see where the coverage was for our specific use case. So it's very tedious to get actual good coverage models, but this kind of gives you a good idea for the, you know, general public median use of it.
Your whole company is that base themselves on smart transportation and so I think there's actually a company in town, I think, that was would sell this to trucking companies, a commercial version. Where are we going with APRS? Is it just kind of like a low-level usage? Is it have a dynamic future where we're going to be changing things and it's going to get more widespread, or is it just kind of like a stasis kind of activity going forward?
It has... A lot of its early growth was spurred on by the collapse of the AX25 network, because all of the AX25 gear was suddenly surplus, and amateurs were asked the question, what can I do with this gear? And so they applied it to APRS. Recently, there's been kind of a second coming for APRS due to the quality of hobbyist embedded systems, like the Raspberry Pi and the BeagleBone from Texas Instruments, has made it easy to put intelligent systems in a relatively small box, right? So something like this, or like this. Like, this is a complete closed tracker. This has got the GPS receiver, the modem, and the transmitter in it. The quality of this stuff has been getting sufficiently better that, yeah, we're starting to see more coverage. Talking to Argent Data, Scott says that about a quarter of his business for people buying his trackers are actually commercial contracts, where police departments are licensing a commercial frequency and using the APRS protocol on it. And so apparently APRS, even though it's been put together with baling wire and duct tape, is relatively good compared to a lot of the other vehicle tracking networks. And so the growth over time for it is actually fairly promising. And so that's why I kind of got inspired to get involved with looking at it from much, you know, taking a step back and looking at it very analytically, because with the quality of these embedded systems we're starting to leverage for it, we really have a lot of potential of making this network significantly more intelligent. But a lot of that is hampered by this legacy support for all of these systems that are never going to change, right? I mean, the DSI digipeater up here, he hasn't changed anything on it in a decade. And so if we come in and we start coming up with new aliases for 20-mile coverage, that doesn't do us much good if no one ever actually implements it. And so I'm optimistic for the future, but it really depends on what other applications people come up with it, other than vehicle location tracking. Cool. Any last questions? Anything at all?
Alright. Have you put together a repeater yet someplace? Or
a digipeater?
Yeah.
Yes. When I lived in San Luis Obispo, I operated a low-level digipeater for my apartment over by Santa Rosa Park. And most importantly, it was a internet gateway with bi-directional capability. Right? The on-campus internet gateway is receive only, but there is instances where you could receive internet traffic that should be gateway to the local area. So like a lot of people will gateway National Weather Service alerts on the local RF network, and my node there was relatively unique in San Luis Obispo at the time in that it had that capability. And so there's actually, there is entirely IP-based trackers for smartphones that I could then sit here and on the campus Wi-Fi text with people driving around San Luis Obispo in their vehicles using the APRS RF network. I would send the text message from here, it would go into the internet APRS internet system, it would arrive at my, it would get routed to my RF gate or internet gateway with RF capabilities on by the park, and then that would transmit it locally on the 100, you know, on the 2 meter frequency, and it would be received by the stations it was destined for. And so I had that set up. Now that I'm living with my parents in the Bay Area, I have no radio set up. They're all in boxes somewhere in the garage. And it's sad.